السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. مساء الخير وويك إند سعيد على الجميع، مليء إن شاء الله بالفائدة. Today we'll speak إن شاء الله about mediastinal masses. Hopefully إن شاء الله it will be very quick review about the common problems that happen with mediastinal disease. If you review the mediastinal masses or the mediastinal conditions, that mean at least 20% of pediatric surgery diseases will be involved in this topic. So that's why it's very broad topic, and it's very difficult to catch it from A to Z. For that reason, there is specific or highlights on some points that I think it's very important to be learned and talk about it during this review course. So the objectives, just quick review about the boundaries of mediastinum, the practical approach of to the mediastinal masses, from the common causes to the clinical presentation, the diagnostic method, the preoperative workup, and then we will highlight some conditions and some important points in different conditions. The practical approach to mediastinal masses is started from knowing the definition of the mediastinum. So first of all, the mediastinal tumor, it's very rare. Despite that, it is still the commonest mediastinum is the commonest location for chest masses in pediatric. 40% of them, they are benign, but around 60% they are malignant. So most of them, they are malignant. Usually they haven't near than 2 years, and the prevalence of malignancy increase with time and then reach the adult percentage, which is around 50%. It's very difficult to, when you see mediastinal mass, to reach diagnosis and need extensive workup from you to reach the diagnosis. And the reason for that, because they have a very different diseases, very different conditions with different origin or pathophysiology for each, but they all share the same finding either clinically or radiologically. So they could be originated from developmental conditions to inflammatory, infectious, to neoplastic conditions. And
sorry to disturb you, but can you use the slideshow? Because the slide is a little bit smaller. Yeah, thank you, great.
Okay. So for easiness of definition, and then because the cluster of conditions in different mediastinum, they start to divide the mediastinum to three compartments: anterior, middle, and posterior compartment. And if you look here, you can see that the anterior mediastinum, it is from the sternum back to the sternum to the anterior to the airway, cardiac, pericardium, and vascular structures. The content there is mainly what we diagnose with 4T, teratoma, thyroid, and then thymus gland, and lymphoma. Then the middle, it's between the vascular structure to near the prevertebral area, and the posterior is from the prevertebral area to the half of the vertebral structures. And each one of these contain a different pathological diagnosis. Filson's is the one who started to classify it, and he aimed from this classification is to decrease or narrow the differential diagnosis in each compartment. Japanese Association, they added another fourth compartments, and they name it the superior portion of the mediastinum, and they think this is different from the anterior mediastinum because the location there and the condition is different from what's happened mainly in the anterior mediastinum. So basically, they divided the anterior mediastinum to superior and inferior anterior mediastinal compartment. Then the middle, they name it the pre-tracheo-syphageal zone, and then the posterior, they name it the paravertebral zone, meaning it's in around the vertebral area. International thymic malignancy interest group, they looked to CT scan finding, and they start to divide it to the prevascular, and then visceral, and then the paravertebral, which is basically similar to the anterior, middle, and the posterior compartments. So mediastinal masses, if you look or compare between the pediatric and the adult, you can find that most of the pediatric patients, they have their masses in the posterior mediastinum, or to account about 65%. While in adults, most of the mediastinal masses, it is in the anterior mediastinal area, which is in 65% also. The other difference between the two, that it is more common to have symptoms with pediatric patients more than the adult patients. And I think the reason for that, it is narrow or small chest cavity. Also, if you look for the nature of the disease in pediatric, malignancy is more common in pediatric. So that will give the invasion to the structures and cause more symptoms. What is your differential diagnosis when you see the mediastinal mass? So basically, there is different ways to the to reach the diagnosis. And one standard thing or one common thing that you will look is this is located to the anterior, middle, or posterior. And then you divide this, what I'm seeing now, do I see a mass? Do I see a fluid, fat, or vascular lesions? From that, you can reach or narrow your differential diagnosis. Other way of the differential diagnosis, it is the same thing, the standard anterior, middle, and posterior, but also you will look for is it benign or malignant. And the commonest, and this is what we are going to follow today, is this differential diagnosis or scheme of reaching the differential diagnosis. The anterior mediastinal mass, teratoma, thymic hyperplasia, thymic cyst, and then you look for lymphoma, which is very common in pediatric age group, and it's the commonest cause of anterior mediastinal masses. Then the malignant germ cells, which is the second cause of mediastinal masses in pediatric age group. Middle, usually it is related to vascular malformation or lymphovascular malformation and the foregut cyst. The posterior, it is related to the tumor like neuroblastoma, ganglioneuroma, and sometimes extension of the foregut cyst. If you notice from this differential diagnosis that there is interfere between the diagnosis from one compartment to the other compartment, because there is no border between the two. It's just imaginary line between them. And the commonest thing that you could see in every compartment is lymphatic malformation. For example, cyst duplication, it can be happening in the middle or posterior mediastinum. So this is just only for easiness of the talk, but it's not common, but happened that you could see what is in the middle, you could find it in the posterior compartment. Clinical presentations, usually nowadays, most of them, they could be presented prenatally and could be diagnosed from prenatal ultrasound. And this is very important because if they diagnose prenatally, this is can help the delivering team and the pediatric team to be arranged for the patient if they need an intervention after during the delivery, like performing an exit procedure if this mass is compressing the airway and they expected the patient cannot maintain the ventilation and the breathing after delivery, then they plan for the exit procedures. Also, there is some fetal intervention, like if the patient has high drops and he has a very huge cystic mass in the cyst, it can be approached during the fetal life and then decompress the cystic component. Incidental, most of them, they will be discovered on performing an X-ray for another lesions. and other conditions, and then they find the mediastinal mass, and the workup start, and they find the patient had mediastinal masses. It could be presented by the mass effect, like compression, direct involvement of the structure, mainly the airway structures. So the patient will present with cough, patient will present with shortness of breath, and then the patient can present with stridor. If they compress the esophagus, they could be presented with dysphagia, hemoptysis, if there is invasion into the airway condition. They could compress the superior vena cava, and then the patient have presented with upper extremities and the facial swelling. Cardiac tamponade also from the mass effect and the Horner syndromes for any involvement of the posterior mediastinal area, especially in the apical part. Systematic symptoms, and this is mainly for the posterior mediastinum, they can presented with the paraneoplastic syndrome, which is a symptoms not related to the mass, and then during the work of the mass, they find the patient has a mediastinal mass, like a patient presented with hypertension, and then they work, they found his catecholamine high, and in the work of the patient, they find the patient has a mediastinal mass. The goal of the preoperative workup, or it's just to identify the diagnosis and then try to reach what is the optimal surgical treatment. How do you approach this patient? And then that's why you need to identify if this is malignant or benign. And the tumor marker that we have there is the alpha fetoprotein and beta HCG that could help us identify if this is malignant or benign condition. This is mainly for the anterior mediastinum, but also for some parts of the posterior mediastinal masses. Urinary catecholamine is another tumor, another test that you could do to detect if the patient has neuroblastoma or component of malignancy in the posterior mediastinum. And this will help you for the finding the surgical approach of the patient. Imaging is the first thing you will do. Just we will start with this image, and you need a lot of collaboration between you and the radiologist. You need the radiologist to read it for you. You need to go there and sit with them and discuss the finding. And usually we will start with the plain chest X-ray, which is the simple one. And the aim of this plain chest X-ray is to define if this is a mediastinal mass or not. Is the mass originated from the mediastinum, from the lung, or from the rib? So that's the first question to answer. If you answer that, then you need to know what is it. Is it from anterior, middle, or posterior mediastinum? And the third question, is there anything that can help me to reach or to suspect a diagnosis in that compartment? If your patient has calcification, if there is fat content, if the cyst, if the patient has just a fluid density component, this is will help you from the X-ray to will help you from the imaging that to reach the diagnosis. Plain X-ray lateral is easy, and this is what we call the Filson methods by anterior, posterior, and middle mediastinal divisions. But also in the AP or PA, you can also detect if this is mediastinal masses or arise from the hemothorax rather than the mediastinum itself. Some things you can see like calcifications, then can help you to see if this is arise mainly from the mediastinum, there is calcium. If you look here, this is, in, for example, is just a diagram to show you the angle. The patient has a mediastinal mass, which is compromising the lung, then usually the edge of the lung here, it's an obtuse and angle. While if you see this is originated from the lung, it will be like an acute angle. And look here, it's from mediastinum. It is, you look for the mediastinal, it is an acute angle for the lung. So that means it's something is pushing on the lung from outside. And this is mainly, this is a mediastinal mass. While if you look here and you see the near border of the lung, It is an obtuse angle, and that means this mass is originated from inside the lung itself. So personally, I may not detect it if I did not go and discuss with the radiologist, and that's why you need the cooperation with the radiologist, because from here they may guide you for the next appropriate diagnostic modalities. Again, lateral, we talk about the lateral, and there is, it's easy to differentiate or to know it is anterior, middle, or posterior. Ultrasound, really there is no benefit or a huge benefit from doing the ultrasound, except it is in the prenatal diagnosis. Cystic component can help you, or usually it is used or utilized the ultrasound for the biopsy procedures. But other than that, cannot tell you more features about the mediastinal mass. CT scan and MRI is the standard of one used for the mediastinal masses. Help to locate the tumor itself. Help you to know, to tell you if this is cystic or solid nature. Differentiate the origin or the invasion to another structures. Can tell you if there is any compression to adjacent structure and mainly the airway, and can characterize the risk of the patient during the surgery. So it can tell you the bronchus itself, the trachea, how much is the compression in the trachea, and help you for planning your next step of management. MRI can give you better definition for vascular masses. It is very good for the posterior mediastinum to see if there is an extension to the intraspinal extension. It helps for differentiating the cystic and solid masses. 18 FDG PET scan, and this is usually specific for lymphoma. If you do it, that means if you suspect lymphoma, this is the one that you could do, and then it tell you there is uptake, then that's it is the lymphoma. Pulmonary function test is rarely indicated. People, if they have shortness of breath, they want to measure the capacity, and they ask for pulmonary function test, especially the anesthesia who's not familiar with the mediastinal masses or working with the mediastinal masses, he will ask for pulmonary function test. This is not helpful, it's just a waste of the time, cannot help or differentiate or give you any extra information for I'm not sure if this is a very important slide in the talk, and I'm not sure if we discussed this. If we discuss it, please tell me so we could stop and go for other slides. Otherwise, we will continue from here. The most important thing for mediastinal mass is that the patient, they may have a respiratory collapse. Either they will have it without intervention when mass is growing, or most commonly, if this patient came to you, they will need an intervention, surgical intervention, either from biopsy or surgical intervention. And this is will risk the patient for a respiratory collapse. And this is usually happen for us, or the risk is maximum at the induction of anesthesia before intubation. And this is due to different, for different reason, like the restrictive condition of the lung from the mass, decrease the venous return, and that make the patient at the risk of collapse. People, they tried to characterize the patient based on their risk, who is at high risk for this collapse. So we can identify who's having the risk. So they came initially by symptoms and radiological finding, and they said, if the patient has orthopnea, and usually in adolescent, not children, adolescents, orthopnea is a major sign for the patient for collapse during the induction of anesthesia. The other factor, it is the CT scan finding. Like if you have a CT scan finding that compression 50% or more of the trachea, then it's high risk. If it is compressing the bronchus with the trachea, even if it is less than 50%, then it's high risk. If it is compressing the trachea and the great vessels, or the patient has upper body edema, then the patient is at high risk. And that's why they have the three categories of patients. Before you have to characterize the patient to one of these three, either he's at low risk, middle risk, or high risk. And this is from symptoms or radiological. If nothing there, neither symptoms nor radiological finding, this is low risk. Go and do your procedure and you are safe. If the patient has one of them or mild both, then it's a very it is a mild risk. I mean, it's just borderline of 50 or less than 50, and the patient doesn't have a very severe symptoms. If the patient has a high or severe symptoms, or the trachea is compressed 50 or more, then the patient is at high risk, and then you should work the patient. Why they do this? Just to find the risk and then prepare yourself for that. There is different methods to be done for biopsy, like fine needle aspiration, pleural fluid aspiration, ultrasound. And unfortunately, most of the time, if they suspect lymphoma, they will ask you for big tissue to take, and this will require thoracoscopy or require Chamberlain approach, which is the anterior mini thoracotomy, or rarely, which we don't do it in pediatric, but maybe in adolescents or late adolescents, it is the mediastinal scope. Is that's why you need which one you are going to choose, which one you are going to give it to your patients. You should know the risk of the patient, go to the anesthetist, sit with the anesthesia, and then discuss with the anesthesia the approach you are going to do. And that's, you have people, they came with this scheme, and I will share the slide with the organizing committee so they can share it with you, because it could go over it later on. But basically the principle from this scheme or theme that you are trying to diagnose the high risk patient without touching the mediastinum itself, without biopsy, without entering the chest, without exposing the patient to general anesthesia. So basically, if the peripheral blood smear give you the diagnosis, excellent. Otherwise, go for bone marrow under local, go for pleural effusion under local, find another, find a lymph node, palpable lymph node somewhere from the body that you could take the diagnosis. If you could not, and the patient is very high risk, then you could start the treatment before the biopsy. And when they start the treatment, I mean by steroid, corticosteroid, they give it for the patient, and it's very good drug that will lead to shrink the tumor itself. But is this is beneficial that we should start the patient? Why we don't start steroid for every patient? Why we don't give the any patient with the mediastinal mass, why we don't give them the steroid and then shrink the mass? Then after that, when the mass shrinks, the risk is less now, we'll go for the pipes. The downside of the steroid that will alter the pathology, that may change the risk, oncology risk for the patient, for the tumor, especially lymphoma. So that's why people, they don't want any treatment before the biopsy, because the chemotherapy types, durations, and number of chemotherapies will be altered depending on the patient risk. So this is the balance. Either you will get to give the steroid or to change the management, or you are not able to characterize the patients to his appropriate oncological stage. Here are two papers that summarize for you, and when you get the slides, you just try to go and look for it. It's very nice papers, easy written, just to tell you the benefit, which is really shrinking the tumor itself, and the downside of using the steroid in managing a patient with mediastinal masses. And the common reason for people to not to do it is just because it's altered the pathology and they may not treat the patient appropriate after. I'll go quickly through this, although I really explained it very well here, but now I think I will go through it. A surgical resection will be through most of the tumor, they will require surgery, either before biopsy, as in first line of treatment, or after biopsy and medical treatment, they will require surgical resection, except in lymphoma and vascular malformation. And there is different method to do it, either through the median sternotomy, thoracotomy on either side, class Mitchell incision, trapdoor incision, Chamberlain incision, or thoracoscopy. Anterior, anterolateral, it's very easy to approach. It's not a straight line because the ribs is not straight, so please don't do it straight, just follow the curve of the lines. It provides you with good exposure to the anterior mediastinum, but if the mass is extended to the posterior, you cannot reach it. When you do it, please pay attention to the future female breast there, not to destroy. Clamshell thoracotomies basically is an extension of the anterolateral thoracotomy in both sides, or you can name it as bilateral, but it's bilaterally separated from the sternum. If you continue between the sternum, it is not bilateral anterolateral incision. So this is a continuous incision. Again, it provides exposure to the anterior mediastinum. It's the same benefit and disadvantage of the anterolateral incisions. Sternotomy, it is a very good to expose the mediastinum, and it's just like opening a book, and then you are there on the mediastinum, you can reach where you want, but it's very aggressive incision. The complication of the sternotomy is more than the thoracotomy. The benefit of it, really, you can extend to the neck, you can extend down to the abdomen, and you can see the anterior and middle mediastinum very clearly from the sternotomy. The posterolateral is very good for posterior mediastinum. It is more muscle here, and that's mean more pain. Scoliosis is more here. That's why the people, they start to come with the what is muscle splitting technique. So please, they say just not to divide, just split the latissimus dorsi and the serratus anterior. Chamberlain, it is in the second intercostal space. You just make an incision, you go in the mass. It is only for biopsy. It is a mini thoracotomy. It's not intended to do the surgical excision. Downside, if you face a problem during the procedure, you have to convert to bigger incision, and you may change the location of the incision. Thoracoscopy, anterior mediastinum, the patient will be supine. Lateral, if it is in the middle, especially the lung. And then the posterior, you have many prone or semi-prone position. The common condition here is just, I'll go very quickly about some highlight conditions here about the anterior mediastinum conditions, each condition, but just I will choose some of them, and they will leave the rest with the slides for you, unless the people, they think they still have a good time to go. I'm not sure about the time now. So the symptoms is more we in the children, and we spoke already about it, because they have malignant more than adult, smaller size, and usually the mass of the anterior mediastinum, they cause symptoms. 75% of symptomatic patients are less than 2 years. So they give you when younger age, they are prone for more symptoms. Don't delay the treatment. That's the message. Second thing, that most of these symptoms, it's related to the compression of the airway. So don't delay the symptoms, because this mass in less than 2 years, it may grow, and then the patient have sudden collapse. I will pay attention thymic hyperplasia. It's a normal variant. It's not abnormal, but the thymus is big in newborn people. And it's not causing any symptoms. The patient is not symptomatic. It's not compressing the trachea, as you see here, but it's big. See the difference between the 3 months and 17 years? In 17 years, they will be like a pot cell sign, what they call it, the pot cell signs. But in 3 months and the patient with the infant, it's very huge mass. Homogeneity of the mass and no symptoms, then this is the classic sign of thymic hyperplasia plus the age. You cannot say thymic hyperplasia in 17-year-old. So infants and the homogeneity of the mass with no symptoms, you don't need to do anything. Observation, rarely the patient, if they get symptoms from large, especially if they are sick children, they may expose to more stress. It's getting more bigger, it causes more symptoms, then you start to treat them either with corticosteroid or you do surgical removal if you cannot control the symptoms with the medical treatment. This is the Same thing, that sometimes they extend to laterally or posterior, extend to the neck, upper neck, or they go down to the mediastinum. They can also extend to the brachiocephalic. So it's benign, but it looks aggressive. The homogeneity, the age, no symptoms, no need for interventions. If the patient exposed to more stress, it will be bigger, but if he's asymptomatic, no need for any treatment. Thymic rebound is another form of thymic hyperplasia, but this is not happening in infant or newborn patient. This is happening for patients who is treated with lymphoma. Then the patient, after treating with lymphoma, they image the patient, they found the thymus is bigger. So what is this? Is this is a rebound or recurrent lymphoma, or this is lymphatic hyperplasia? This is where you do the PET PET scan can help you to differentiate. If the uptake is there, it's lymphoma. If no uptake there, it's the lymphatic hyperplasia. And again, the treatment is the same as observation. Unless you could not differentiate and you have risk that it's lymphoma, then you have to biopsy. But usually the PET scan can tell you the difference between the two. Sometimes it's normal lymph node. There's lymph nodes there, but it's not significant. Patient has a recent infections, patient has chronic infections in the lung, and then they have the mediastinal lymph nodes. Considered to be normal. Usually any cyst, any lymph node less than 1 centimeter cannot be seen by CT scan. In radiology department, the people, they look for the signs of the, they call it the azygosophageal recess, and they look for the convex and concave shape. And if you look here in this area, this is a concave shape, and this is normal in a patient who is less than 2 years. From 2 to around 8-9 years, it will be straight, but then it will be convex if it's the patient at puberty or adolescent period. If they saw these signs with appropriate age, this is normal lymph nodes, no need for biopsy. If it is opposite, like if you see the signs of adolescence in infant or in 5 or 4 years, then you have to biopsy the lymph nodes because it could represent a medical condition, i.e. lymphoma. Hodgkin's lymphoma and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, it's very common to have in the anterior mediastinum. Hodgkin's lymphoma happen in the adolescence period. Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma happened in any age. The prognosis of Hodgkin's is better. The difference between them, it's actually, or the accurate differentiation between the two, it's happened by doing the biopsy and start the treatment. But sometimes you can expect if it is Hodgkin or non-Hodgkin's lymphoma or age of presentation, it's any age, this is the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. If the patient has just only in the adolescence, then it could be most likely it's Hodgkin lymphoma. Distribution of the lymph node, if it is everywhere, then you think about non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Blood test, especially uric acid and LDH with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma more than Hodgkin's lymphoma. But still in lymphoma, I think the biopsy and good chunk of the biopsy is the way you go. Here you can see the mass, you can see the compression of the trachea of the Hodgkin's lymphoma. And also you can see that's extensive between the anterior and the middle mediastinal mass. And the PET scan is positive for that. And as you see here, it's coming in all the chest is full of the lymph nodes. Non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, usually the size is smaller, but it can be big as Hodgkin's lymphoma. Again, you cannot differentiate. And you see extra, and this is very important because you may biopsy from there, extra thoracic extension or metastasis. Germ cell tumor teratoma, I think you had the teratoma today. So I will go very fast, but it represents 10 to 15% of the anterior mediastinal masses. It's very important to differentiate. This is primary germ cell tumor of the mediastinum, or it is secondary from the germ cell from the testes or ovaries. You cannot if you see mediastinal germ cell tumor, then please do an ultrasound to the abdomen female and the scrotum in the male, just to rule out, or maybe MRI if you are still not cleared, just to rule out if this is secondary germ cell tumor. This is the message I want from the mediastinal germ cell tumor. Teratoma, it is the commonest, and it's account for 60% of all germ cell tumor in the mediastinum. It's account for 16% of all mediastinal masses. I think it just today is very, you talk one about teratoma, so there is no point to go about the pathology or from where it's coming. It could be originated from the thymus itself, but it could be from anywhere. In the chest, it is more common in girls more than boys. But with adolescents, they are equal, boys and boys and girls. But early, it's more in girls. Usually, it's diagnosed prenatally. Alpha fetoprotein is a very good marker because it gives you the malignancy. It is mature or immature teratoma, and this is will lead you for the second line of management. So, if it is not sure, if you are not sure if it is malignant or not, please take the precautions of oncological surgery and don't disturb rupture the tumor and then cause recurrence and decrease the survival of the patient. CT scan, the fat content is the key. So if you do CT scan, if you see fat, most likely this is teratoma, and then the people, the radiologists will tell you this is most likely teratoma. So fat content, it can indicate this the anterior mediastinal mass is teratoma. And if you look here, this is the cystic, could be cystic, water content, and then if the teratoma it's containing the fat content, then you think this is most likely it is teratoma. Size is not an indicator of malignancy. So big size could be mature teratoma, small size it could be immature teratoma, and it is a malignancy. That's the problem of teratoma. See, the most common cause of fat lesion is the anterior mediastinum, and it is the second common cause of anterior mediastinal mass in children after lymphoma. So if there is anterior mediastinal mass with fat, it is teratoma. It is 90% is benign, but 10% can be malignant. That's why you should look for the signs of malignancy like irregular type, if you have pulmonary or liver metastasis, liver invasion, if you have less fat content and more solid component, and this is can tell you or alert you of malignancy. Treatment is surgical removal, and usually you do it through the lateral thoracotomy or median sternotomy or thoracoscopy. Very important to follow the oncology treatment, especially if it is malignancy. Don't be going for thoracoscopy and then you rupture the teratoma and it is immature, then you risk the patient for recurrence or future germ cell tumors or other types of malignancy. They have an excellent prognosis after removal. So even if the patient required median sternotomy, do it just because the prognosis very, it's affected by the resection or either complete or not. Other type, there is another type of germ cell tumor that can happen in the chest and very rare, but they are all malignant if it's happening. If not teratoma, then they are malignant. Alpha fetoprotein or beta CG is diagnostic for them and they require chemotherapy. Then after that, a surgical resection. We spoke already about the thymic hyperplasia and then thymic cyst. Thymic cyst happen because thymus is originated from the third pharyngeal pouch, and it's descend down to the, it starts in the neck and then descend down to the chest. When they descend with thymopharyngeal duct and then obliterate later on. Any resistance of this can lead to formation of the cyst. They present with like any other mediastinal mass, and they lined with pharyngeal epithelial line, and pathological is pathognomic for them. It looks like a rose there, and you can see the Hassel corpuscle, and they name it the Hassel corpuscle for them, and this lymphocyte is there. So this is thymic cyst. CT scan, you can see it's very thin water density cyst and need operation for removal because it may expand and cause more symptoms. And this is very good for thoracoscopic approach, but you can approach it through cervical if it is in the upper part of the mediastinum or transsternal. Thymoma or thymic carcinoma, this is the problem. How do you differentiate between them? Which one is thymoma, which one is thymic carcinoma? We now know how to differentiate between thymic hyperplasia and malignancy. Now, how do you differentiate between the two kinds of malignancy? If there is a tibia, then if there is no tibia, then this is thymoma. If there is clear-cut tibia, then what we call a thymic epithelial tumor. If the patient has no longer specific thymic tissue, the people, they cannot characterize if this is thymus or not, this is what we call the C-thymoma. So the thymic carcinoma, when they cannot recognize it, or with the patient with a tibia, then they call it the thymic carcinoma. When the patient, they cannot recognize it, they call it the C-thymoma. Vascular invasion, if you see it by CT scan or imaging, they can indicate the metastasis. Other tumor that involve the thymus, it's different germ cell lymphoma, carcinomas, or carcinoid. In anterior mediastinal masses, there was a review from 1973 to 2008 for 73 cases of malignant, only the malignant anterior mediastinal tumors. Most of them, they are thymoma. 29 is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and 22 is Hodgkin's lymphoma. Combination is giving the lymphoma the higher percentage more than the thymoma. The prognosis improved with improved the treatment protocol. And if you see, like, the period between 1973 to 1989, the survival only is 18%, but from 1991 to 2008, the survival is 75. I think this is because the protocol, the treatment protocol, the surgical, and the improvement in the surgical excision, the awareness of the disease itself. They present with the same like mediastinal masses, but also they can present in 40% with paraneoplastic syndrome. They may present with myasthenia gravis in 30% of adolescents or adult patients. They could be present with endocrine diseases like hyperthyroidism, Addison disease. They can present with autoimmune diseases like SLE, rheumatoid arthritis, or other like kidney disease, like the nephrotic diseases. This is the thymoma. And if you look here to differentiate between the two, the one in the left side, this is the large one, which is the thymoma. And the thymic carcinoma, when there is invasion to the vessels. Treatment is the surgery, but if you cannot resect it, then you have to do radiotherapy, or if you you could resect it but not complete, then you have to do the radiotherapy. In refractory cases or very advanced cases, then you start the chemotherapy with cisplatin based chemotherapy. This is response with survival is around 50% with the carcinoma. People start with refractory cases that you cannot treat them. If you put them in octreotide or sunitinib, then the patient, they sustain or stabilize the disease in about 75% of the cases. Thyroid, it's very rare to have in pediatric. I will not go through it. Personally, I never saw a thyroid extending to the chest. It's probably when they reach the adolescent time, which is considered adolescent, they are already here in our age group under the adult, but this is one of your differential diagnosis. Mediastinum, just I will speak about the lymphangioma and foregut cyst, about just few points. The vascular tumor or anomalies, when I mean just hemangioma or lymphatic malformations, it is located in the all over the body. Very rare to be located in the mediastinum, and it is more rare to be isolated to the mediastinum. It is very difficult to deal with. Have a very range from stable, small to progressive and big conditions. It is usually the hemangioma is continuity with other parts in the body. Surgical resection, if it is in the mediastinum, it is the main treatment options if the patient is symptomatic. Surgical option for the treatment of hemangioma in a symptomatic patient is not indicated. In asymptomatic patient is not indicated. If the patient is symptomatic, then you start the patient with the beta blocker, a steroid, try to control the symptoms. Then if not, then you go for surgical excision. So again, the surgical for asymptomatic patient is not indicated. Even the treatment for asymptomatic patient is not indicated. For symptomatic patient, try the medical treatment, and rarely you require the surgery, but sometimes you may face that you need to go to remove it because you are not able to control the symptoms. This is the medical treatment. Either you will go give glucocorticoids, or you give the beta blocker, or you give local glucocorticoids or interferon. Interferon for refractory one. The glucocorticoids was the first line of treatment. Efficacy was reaching around 84%, and this is the dose of 2.9 milligram per kg. But now I think that first line of treatment is the beta blocker, and the regimen of do it is either to start gradually, and either you will do it inside the hospital when you start, or you do it outside the hospital. So you do the beta blocker inside the hospital for the hemangioma in general, and especially for the one in the chest, if the patient is less than 8 weeks or have a comorbidity or symptomatic. So you have to be as inpatient. You start with the low dose, 1 milligram per kg per day, divided in three doses, so 0.33 for each dose. And then you give it there, you measure the blood pressure, you measure the heart rate, and then you assess for 1 to 3 doses. If the patient tolerates it, you go for bigger doses until you reach the maximum dose, which is the 2 milligram per kg per day. Then if the patient is stable, you discharge the patient on the same regimen at home. But if the patient is more than 8 weeks, it could be done as outpatients. But when you change the dose, you have to bring the patient to the ER. So when you start the dose, the first dose, you bring the patient for 1 to 2 hours in the ER. You give them the beta blocker. You watch them there. If they are okay, then you send them home for 3 to 7 days. Bring them after, increase to 0.5 milligram per kg per dose. The same thing for 3 to 7 days. And then after that, return to increase it to the maximum dose, sending them home to continue the treatment. Sometimes the patient that doesn't respond to the dose. So people, they try to increase the dose to 2.5. And here there is a very good review of cases that they increase the doses to 2.5 milligram, and there is no benefit from increasing the dose. If the patient did not respond to 2 milligram per kg per day, he will not respond to any other doses or bigger doses. Which one of all these medical treatments is the best? By meta-analysis, beta blocker is the best, and it is the least side effect and the best control of symptoms and regression of the size. But if you start any one of these treatments, please start it early before you miss the proliferative phase, and the patient will not respond from that. Here, the vascular, you see the hemangioma. You can see here in the left side, number one, that it is a homogeneous mass, but then in arterial phase, it's filled with blood. The lymphatic malformation, it is one of the vascular anomalies there, and it's just either micro or macrocyst. The treatment there should be observation unless the patient is symptomatic. And if the patient start to be symptomatic, then you start to see, okay, what's next treatment? Usually, if the patient has macrocyst, then it is the best outcome that can, and it's controlled, very small macrocyst, and that you can excise completely, doesn't danger the other structures, then the surgical treatment is the best. If it is microcyst and or macrocyst but big, you cannot excise it, then you go for the other alternative treatment. And here the MRI for lymphatic malformation, you can see it can be invading different structures, and surgical excision sometimes is not easy to do. It is a disease that can nodulate spontaneously, but it benefits from surgical intervention if it is symptomatic and localized. People, they start to talk about if it is okay, microcyst, then we give the sirolimus. And this is, they may help the patient to decrease their symptoms and regress the disease itself. Macrocystic, now will you give a sclerosing agent or you will resect it? There's a debate, and there was a debate before, but the recent studies show the safety of doing the sclerosing agent for these conditions. The problem of doing the sclerosing agent for this condition is that the day after sclerosing agents, that there will be swelling, edema, and you may cause bigger size of the tumor and cause compartment in the lung and the heart. So that's the people, that's why they are worried from doing the sclerosing agents. People, they try to put pigtail and they try to put a chest tube inside it after injection, keep it open the night or the day after to decrease this chance. But I think it's an edema, it's not fluid that you can drain it. One of the papers that say the medical treatment is feasible for these patients, like by our colleague, Dr. Akram Al-Jahdali and his team, they manage successfully and a very small baby with huge mediastinal lymphangioma with a sclerosing agent, and then they start the patient's one, I think, sirolimus, and then the patient's doing well, recovered very well. So this is very good way, but may start there, take the risk that the patient may require thoracotomy. They may require coming, pay attention, tell the family that you may take the patient middle of night to open the chest to decompress the edema and the compartment that happened after the injection. But I think I will do it before doing the surgical treatment, especially in macrocystic big mass. For gut cyst, this is the posterior mediastinum. It's just usually asymptomatic. It is either bronchial or esophageal. It depends on where they differentiate. The count about 10%. Do it early, because if you diagnose it, because they can grow and can cause symptoms, can become infected, and then can cause symptoms for the patients. Diagnosis, it's very by chest X-ray. You can see the mass itself, or you could see here the cyst itself. Sometimes it could be huge and compressing the lung and causing symptoms. Could be extended either to neck or the abdomen, especially the duplicated cyst, esophageal cyst, it could go down to the abdomen. With the contrast, you could see the compression, or the endoscopy, you could see the cyst itself from there. Treatment options, surgical excision is the standard treatment of them. Some people, they just do the endoscopic and they report a couple of cases with no recurrence, as you see here. Just it's the big mass, they open it, and then the patient recovered later. And just this endoscopic treatment still is a case reported, and there is no comparison or between it and the surgical excision. If this is proven to be beneficial for the patient, I think it's much better than complete excision with the thoracoscopy. And this is much easier for the patients. But I think you need more study for that. Posterior mediastinum is neuroblastoma. I think I did the neuroblastoma last year, and I think you have neuroblastoma this year. So if the team allow me to stop here and just take a questions, and thank the people for giving me the time. Unless they want me to go through it, I will go. But I think it's just we repeat what's said in neuroblastoma lectures. And thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ali, for the informative and comprehensive lecture. And we are very sorry for the technical problem. If you don't mind, we can move to the question. We have one question. What is the best way to get a biopsy in patient with a high risk of having airway collapse under GA?
Well, I think high risk, you should not take him under if it is really high risk. And it's just high risk. You should not take him to GA. You should try it under local. If you have the patient, you could take it from bone marrow, take it from bone marrow. If you could take it from the other lymph nodes in the neck, you could take it from the other lymph nodes in the neck. Pleural effusion by aspiration under local. This is another way of doing it. If you could not, and the patient is very high risk for biopsy, start with the steroid and then let it shrink down and then come back later on for biopsy.
There's another question. What is the best management of asymptomatic child with neuroenteric cyst?
Neuroenteric cyst, I think it should be excised because they can grow. Any cyst there can grow and can get infected. And thoracoscopic approach is the best for them to manage, unless there is some neurological symptoms, then you have to you and your spine surgeon or the people who's dealing with the spinal surgery in your department with you in the procedure itself.
Afid, there is another question. Any rule for thymectomy in case of myasthenia gravis in pediatric population?
Yes, and if you we do it in our centers, and there is a role for thymectomy for myasthenia gravis with good outcome, and we usually receive the call from the neurology people and they start them in the medical treatment. If they respond to the medical treatment, then we know that the patient will respond to the thymectomy. We had a couple of cases we did, and the patient, they respond either resolved, or some of them, they decrease the requirement of the medications. I think it's there is a big role for that.
Okay, great. Thank you, Dr. Ali, for your outstanding presentation. We really appreciate your effort and time. And we hope to hear from you again, inshallah.
Thank you. Thank you all for listening for me. Thank you for inviting me. This is really very good course. Successful, great presenters. And I hope the best for all of you.
Thank you so much.